Hello friends, welcome to another lecture of machine design. In past few lectures we saw how to design against static load, how to design against fluctuating load and how to design brakes. In today's lecture we are going to see how to design clutch, and trust me my friend, you might have never seen design of clutch like this before. You might have never understood the clutch in this way before. Today we are going to learn how exactly the clutch looks in real life, how it exactly works through animations, my friend. आज का जो वीडियो रहेगा वो completely full of animations रहेगा, ताकि आप समझ सकें कि exactly clutch कैसा दिखता है और कैसा work करता है. So be there till the end, my friend, and I guarantee you, you will not regret it. You will understand the clutch in a very unique way, my friend. Okay? Now, my friend, welcome to our YouTube channel, Unacademy Gate ME, which is dedicated to mechanical engineers. ये YouTube चैनल इकलौता YouTube चैनल है इंडिया का आज की डेट में, which is only made for mechanical engineers, जहां सिर्फ mechanical engineers की लाइव क्लासेस होती है, my friend, और किसी भी ब्रांच की नहीं. And this is the team of Unacademy Gate ME, which consists of the finest teachers in India right now, my friend. So don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you have not subscribed till now. अगर आपने अभी तक subscribe नहीं किया है तो आप जुर्म कर रहे हैं. Please subscribe the channel right now and don't forget to press the bell icon, because the bell icon will give you the notifications whenever we will be live and you will never miss a lecture. Bell icon दबाना बहुत जरूरी है ताकि आपको सारी notifications time to time मिलती रहे. And my friend, in order to grow in numbers, in order to reach to maximum number of students, we need your support. Please copy the link of this video right now. Abhi karo, copy the link and post it in your WhatsApp, my friend. Send it to at least three of your friends. And if you have WhatsApp groups of college or WhatsApp group of students, please paste the link of this video in your WhatsApp groups, my friend. In order to grow, we need your support, my friend. So do this for us, ताकि हम ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा content बना सके, so that we can make more lectures, we can make more videos, my friend. Okay? Now those of you who are watching me for the first time, let me introduce myself. My name is Apurup Rao. I know it is a difficult name. It is hard to pronounce. It is pronounced as Apurup. Apurup Rao. I am M.Tech from IIT Kharagpur and my specialization was mechanical systems design. I was always fascinated by design, so I wanted to study design. So I took specialization as mechanical systems design. And then after my post-graduation, I worked in Mahindra Research Valley, which is the research and development center of Mahindra and Mahindra Automobile and Tractors. It is located in Chennai. And there Mahindra ki cars and Mahindra के सारे tractors basically design होते हैं. So it is the design center of Mahindra Automobile and Tractors. So I worked there for 2 years as deputy manager. And what was my work? My work was related to the design and analysis of the body parts, my friend. जितने भी body parts होते हैं car के, doors, instrument panel, chassis, all these body parts, they are designed and analyzed in a particular way. So I used to do that. I was in that team, my friend. And some of the finest cars of Mahindra are designed in Mahindra Research Valley. Mahindra XUV, Mahindra TUV, Mahindra KUV. But I always had a passion for teaching. So I quit my job after 2 years and I started teaching. So I've been teaching for more than 6 years now. I teach the subjects related to design, because I have worked in design, I have studied design, so I teach subjects related to design, strength of material, machine design, engineering mechanics and theory of machines. I have recently completed the entire syllabus of strength of material. I have covered as many topics as I could, so you can go and watch the videos also. And in this lecture series, we are going to complete machine design, my friend. Okay, so let's not waste any more time and let's start with the topic, my friend. Today's topic is design of clutch. And today we are going to see how exactly a clutch looks and how it works through some animations, my friend. Aaj ka jo video hai, wo full of animations hone wala hai, taki aap log samajh sake ki clutch dikhta kaise hai, clutch kaise kaam karta hai, कहां यूज होता है, कौन सा क्लच किस फील्ड में यूज होता है. ओके, सो लेट्स फर्स्ट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट एग्जैक्टली क्लच इज. यू ऑल नो व्हाट क्लच इज, बट इन टेक्निकल वे व्हाट एग्जैक्टली क्लच इज, वेयर दिस फिट्स, लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड दैट. सो क्लच इज बेसिकली अ मैकेनिकल डिवाइस यूज्ड टू कनेक्ट और डिसकनेक्ट ड्राइविंग शाफ्ट एंड ड्रिवन शाफ्ट, सो दैट द ड्रिवन शाफ्ट कैन बी स्टॉप्ड विदाउट स्टॉपिंग द ड्राइविंग शाफ्ट. बेसिकली क्लच इज यूज इन ऑटोमोबाइल, इट इज यूज इन एवरी मशीनरी, बट हियर माई फ्रेंड वी विल अंडरस्टैंड द क्लच फ्रॉम द ऑटोमोबाइल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, व्हीकल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, बिकॉज यू विल बी एबल टू रिलेट. ओके, बिकॉज यू नो ऑल पजेस व्हीकल्स, यू ऑल हैव सीन व्हीकल्स, सो यू विल बी एबल टू रिलेट दिस क्लच फ्रॉम द व्हीकल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, फ्रॉम द ऑटोमोबाइल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. ओके, सो वॉट इज क्लच माई फ्रेंड. सी, इन एवरी मशीनरी there is a power source, there is an input, and then there is an output. For example, in automobile, what is your input, my friend? The power coming from engine. Okay, that is your input. Engine is your input. And what is your output? The transmission, my friend. Gears and wheels. These are output, my friend, right? So you have to transfer the power from input to output. And how do you do that, my friend? We cannot permanently connect the two shafts, driving shaft and driven shaft. Driving shaft is attached to the engine, driven shaft is attached to the transmission. So we cannot completely connect, we cannot permanently connect them. Otherwise what will happen? Let's say you have permanently connected the two shafts, okay? So whenever you need to stop the transmission, whenever you need to stop the wheels, you have to kill the engine, you have to stop the engine. But we cannot do that. Let's say you are waiting in a traffic signal for 5 seconds or 10 seconds. Okay, let's say you are waiting in a traffic signal for 10 seconds. You want your wheels to be stopped. You want your wheels to be stopped for 10 seconds, but you don't want the engine to be stopped. Okay, you don't want to kill the engine. You don't want the engine to be stopped. You want the engine running, but the wheels must be stopped. So that means there must be a temporary connection, right? There must be a temporary connection which can be disconnected whenever you want. Okay, if you permanently connect them, so whenever you need to stop the wheels, you have to stop the engine, right? But if you temporarily connect them, then you can disconnect the wheels from the engine whenever you want. Okay, let's say right now they are connected, they both are rotating. But let's say you want to stop the wheels, but the engine must be running. Just disconnect them. So clutch is a temporary connection between the driving shaft and the driven shaft. It is a temporary connection between the driving and the driven shaft so that you can disconnect the driven shaft whenever you want. It is in your control, my friend. Okay, let's understand it using a schematic diagram. So this is a schematic diagram, my friend. This is the engine side. This is the power source, the input. Okay, this is the driving shaft. Okay, this is the driving shaft. And this is the transmission, my friend, gears, and there is wheel also. Here there will be wheels, okay? So this is the transmission output and this is the engine input. Between input and output, there is clutch, my friend, so that you can connect the transmission and disconnect the transmission whenever you want, my friend. It will be in your control. Engine will be continuously running, but transmission, when it will run, when it is connected to the engine, and if you disconnect it, it will stop running, my friend. Okay, so this is the interface, this is the temporary joint between the transmission and the engine. Okay, so engine and transmission cannot be permanently connected, otherwise whenever you have to stop the transmission, you will have to stop the engine, you will have to kill the engine. But you don't want to do that. Engine must be continuously running. Whenever you want to stop the transmission, just disconnect the clutch. Okay, so this is the flywheel, my friend. This is the flywheel which is connected to the driving shaft. Okay, what is the use of flywheel? That you will see in theory of machines. Okay, what is the use of flywheel? What is the design process of flywheel? That you will cover in the theory of machines, my friend. Here we are concerned about the design of clutch. Okay, so flywheel is connected to the input, it is continuously rotating. Whenever you will connect the clutch with the flywheel, then transmission will also start to rotate. And if you disconnect the clutch from the flywheel, then it will stop rotating, my friend. The transmission will stop rotating. So do you understand this, my friend? From the vehicle point of view, I am explaining so that you'll be able to understand it better. You'll be able to connect them. You'll be able to feel them. Okay. All right, my friend. Now let's see what are the different types of clutch. So basically there are different types of clutch. Nowadays there are electromagnetic clutch also. Okay, आजकल electromagnetic clutches भी आ गए हैं, काफी तरक्की कर ली है साइंस ने. लेकिन हमको बेसिकली जो क्लचेस पढ़ने हैं, दो टाइप के क्लच हमको देखने हैं, पॉजिटिव क्लच, फ्रिक्शन क्लच. ओके, सो बेसिकली क्लच कैन बी डिवाइडेड इनटू टू कैटेगरीज, पॉजिटिव क्लच एंड फ्रिक्शन क्लच. ओके, लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज पॉजिटिव क्लच फर्स्ट. ओके, लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज पॉजिटिव क्लच एंड फ्रिक्शन क्लच एंड देन वी विल कम बैक टू दिस स्लाइड माय फ्रेंड, बिकॉज यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन द टू. ओके, आपको इन दोनों के बीच का अंतर भी समझ में आना चाहिए. तो पहले हम दोनों क्लचेस को समझ लेते हैं, फिर वापस आएंगे इस स्लाइड पे. ओके, सो पॉजिटिव क्लच एग्जांपल इज जॉ क्लच. ओके, लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज अ जॉ क्लच. सो बेसिकली माय फ्रेंड, इन केस ऑफ जॉ क्लच देयर आर टीथ इन द इनपुट एंड द आउटपुट. ओके, दिस इज द, लेट्स से दिस इज द इनपुट क्लच एंड दिस इज द आउटपुट क्लच. ओके, ये इनपुट पार्ट है, ये आउटपुट पार्ट है, जिन दोनों में टीथ बने हुए हैं. जस्ट लाइक गियर्स देयर आर टीथ, सो व्हेनेवर दिस टीथ आर कनेक्टेड टुगेदर देन they both are connected and the output starts rotating. And if you want the output to stop, then you just disconnect them. Okay? So whenever you need to connect them, they will be connected like this. Okay? The teeth will match. The teeth will match. They are matching teeth. So they will match each other. And if you want to stop this, just disconnect them. Okay? So do you understand this? This type of engagement is known as positive engagement, my friend. When the teeth of clutch are connected together, this engagement is known as positive engagement. Now understand, what do we mean by positive engagement? See, in case of friction clutches, the second type of clutch is friction clutch, we use friction to connect and disconnect the clutches. Okay, in this case, whenever there is friction, there will be slip, my friend. What is slip? Let's say this is your input and this is your output. Okay, input is continuously rotating. Okay, if you connect them, output must also be rotating, right? अगर ये घूम रहा है तेजी से तो ये भी साथ में घूमना चाहिए. अगर मान लो, let's say input is rotating but output suddenly stops for some time. Okay, input is rotating, they are connected, but input is rotating and output is stopped for some time, it does not rotate. So this is known as slip, my friend. Okay, this is known as slip. Okay, input is rotating and output did not rotate. So this is known as slip, which occurs in case of friction clutch. In case of friction clutch, slip occurs. But in case of jaw clutch, in case of jaw clutch, the engagement is positive. Here the teeth are matching. The teeth are connected. So there will never be slip. In gears also, there is no slip, my friend. So these type of engagement is known as positive engagement. Okay, in jaw clutch, in gears, what do we have? We have teeth which connect with each other. So this type of engagement is known as positive engagement. Why? Because there is no slip, my friend. Okay, there will never be slip. If this is rotating and it is connected, then this will always rotate. There will be no slip. Okay, now my friend, let's understand the working of jaw clutch using animation, my friend. I told you there will be lots of animation in clutch. Okay, so let's understand the working using the animation. See, this is your input. This green part is your input and this yellow part is your output. Okay, and you can see that there are matching teeth on input and output, my friend. There are matching teeth. Okay, so whenever you need to connect them, whenever you need to connect them, you will just apply an axial force. This will be an axial force, right? In this direction, if you apply the force, it will be axial force. So whenever you need to connect them, just apply axial force and it will be connected. See, this is connected right now. So it will start to rotate. This yellow part will start to, the output will start to rotate. The green part is your input, which is continuously rotating. But yellow part is output. Whenever you need to connect them, whenever you need to connect them, you will apply an axial force, it will be connected and it will start rotating. Okay, see, it was disconnected, now we applied an axial force, it is connected. See, the teeth are matching. Okay, the teeth are matching, they are perfectly connected. This is a positive engagement, so there will never be any slip, my friend. Okay, so this is jaw clutch. Okay, this is jaw clutch. Now let's understand friction clutch. Let's understand friction clutch. In case of friction clutch, my friend, the power is transferred by the friction between the surfaces. In case of jaw clutch, In case of friction clutch, the power is transferred by friction. Okay. Now understand the working of friction clutch through the animation. So this is the friction clutch, my friend. Okay. Let's say this B and C. These are friction plates. Okay. These are friction plates, my friend. A is input and D is output. Okay. A is input and D is output, my friend. Right now, they are disengaged. Right now, they are disengaged. See, this input is rotating, but the output is not rotating. Now, if you want to engage them, what you will do? Again, you will apply an axial force. Just like jaw clutch, you will apply axial force. So, now, this second clutch will connect with the first clutch. See, this C will be connected with B. Okay? There is no positive engagement. There are no teeth. There is no positive engagement. Why these two will start rotating with each other? Because of friction, my friend. What is the use of, what is the work of friction, my friend? What is the objective of friction? The friction opposes relative motion. Relative motion, okay? So if this is running and there is friction between these two surfaces, there will be no relative motion. So this will also start to run, my friend, okay? This will also start to run. There will be no relative motion. Relative motion means one is running and other one is stopped. So friction opposes the relative motion. Okay. So look at this. Look at this. These two plates are connected together by means of friction. There is no positive engagement. There is no positive engagement, my friend. There are no teeth. They are just touching each other. The friction surfaces are just touching each other. So here the transfer of power is taking place due to friction, my friend. Okay. So this case, in this case, there will be slip, my friend, during the engagement, there will be slip for some time. Once they are connected properly, then there is no slip. But during the engagement, there is some slip, my friend. Okay. So this is known as friction clutch. In case of jaw clutch, there is no slip, my friend. Why? Because there are positive engagement, there is matching teeth. So do you understand, my friend, this basic difference between jaw clutch and friction clutch? In jaw clutch, there are matching teeth, okay? And in friction clutch, there is no matching teeth. There are just surfaces and there is friction between surfaces, okay? Now, my friend, what is the difference? This is very important, my friend. You will see some problems based on this difference, my friend. Okay, so understand the difference, okay? In case of positive clutch, why they are called positive clutch? Because of positive engagement. Positive engagement means no slip. Okay, understand this. Note it down somewhere. Positive engagement means no slip. So whenever you have two devices connected together by means of teeth, okay, matching teeth, then it is positive engagement. For example, gears. In gears also, there are matching teeth and gears are connected together by means of these teeth. So gears are also positive. Okay. गियर जो है वो भी पॉजिटिव ड्राइव कहलाते हैं. व्हाई? क्योंकि उनमें मैचिंग टीथ होते हैं. ओके, सो दिस इज पॉजिटिव एंगेजमेंट. हियर स्लिप ऑकर्स ड्यूरिंग एंगेजमेंट. ओके, नॉट एंटायर टाइम. ओके, द स्लिप विल नॉट बी ऑल द टाइम, ओनली ड्यूरिंग द एंगेजमेंट. व्हेन यू आर अप्लाइंग द एक्सियल फोर्स एंड इट इज कनेक्टेड ड्यूरिंग द एंगेजमेंट फॉर सम टाइम, देयर विल बी स्लिप. ओके, नाउ माय फ्रेंड, due to the matching teeth, what happens? There is sudden engagement, my friend. When positive clutch is connected, there is sudden engagement. It is suddenly connected. So all the power is suddenly transferred, my friend. Okay. Suppose this is rotating and this is stopped. Okay. When you will connect this teeth, then all the power of the input will suddenly transfer to the output. So this is sudden engagement, my friend, which is not good. Why it is not good, my friend? Because if there is sudden engagement, then there will be jerk, my friend. Then there will be jerk. There will be shock. There will be vibration. So that's why, my friend, positive clutches cannot be connected at high speeds. If you try to connect them at high speed, what will happen, my friend? If you try to, let's say it is moving at very high speed and then you are connecting them, then all the power will be suddenly transferred and there will be vibration, there will be shock, my friend. Okay, there will be wear and tear. See, this is made of metal. So if you connect them suddenly, then what will happen, my friend? There will be wear and tear, there will be vibration, high shock. So that's why whenever you need to engage the clutch, you have to reduce the speed. Okay, you have to reduce the speed of input. Okay, this driving shaft, you have to reduce the speed so that it can be connected and there will be no much shock, there will be not much of vibration, and then you increase the speed. Okay, but in case of friction clutch, there is smooth engagement, there is no sudden engagement, it is gradually connected. When you press this plate, this is the friction plate, this is the friction plate, when you will press these plates, they will not be connected suddenly. Okay, they will not be connected suddenly, there will be gradual engagement. I told you, there is slip, my friend. Initially there is slip. Once they are properly connected, then this will start to rotate properly. Okay, so the power of transfer in case of friction clutch is not sudden, it is gradual, my friend. Okay, smooth engagement. Okay, so that's why in case of friction clutch, you don't have to reduce the speed of the driving shaft. It can be connected at high speed without any vibration, without any shock, my friend. So do you understand this main difference between positive clutch and friction clutch? Positive clutches are sudden engagement. In positive clutch, there is sudden engagement, sudden transfer of power. That's why we have to reduce the speed of the input shaft. But in friction clutches, there is gradual engagement. Okay, gradual engagement due to slip. There is gradual engagement, and that's why we don't have to reduce the speed, my friend. Even if it is rotating at very high speed, you can connect them. They will be gradually connected and the power transfer will take place gradually. So no vibration, no shock, my friend. Okay. Positive clutches are mainly used in power press, rolling mills, etc. Machineries like this. But in case of automobile, cars, bikes, everywhere, friction clutches are used. Okay, so in our daily life, whatever clutch we see, it is a friction clutch. Okay, it is a friction clutch. Positive clutches are not used in automobile because of jerk, because of vibration. Okay, we have to, in case of automobile, we have to connect the clutch at high speed. So that's why we cannot use positive clutch. Okay, so my friend, in our syllabus, we only have design of friction clutch. We are not going to see the design part of positive clutch. We will only design friction clutch, my friend. Okay, this is the working of friction clutch. Let's understand one more time. So what happens, my friend? There are two plates, okay, friction surfaces basically. So when you connect them, then what will happen? Between these two plates, there will be friction. So this second plate will also start to rotate. Why? Because friction opposes relative motion. Relative motion, my friend. Friction does not oppose motion, it opposes relative motion. Okay, so if one surface is moving and another surface is stopped, then due to friction, this surface will also start to move because there should not be any relative motion, my friend. Okay, that's why we can connect them at very high speed because there is smooth engagement, my friend. Smooth engagement. Okay, so we have to see the design process of friction clutch. Okay. Let's understand friction clutch. Now, my friend, there are different types of friction clutch, and in every case, the working is a little different. Okay. What are the different types? There are three basic types of friction clutch: plate clutch, cone clutch, centrifugal clutch. Okay. Plate clutch, cone clutch, centrifugal clutch. We have to see the design process of every friction clutch. Okay. तो हम तीनों clutches को detail में पढ़ने वाले हैं: plate clutch, cone clutch, and centrifugal clutch. Okay. Now, my friend, plate clutch is made of a circular plate. It is of the shape of a circular plate. In case of plate clutch, the clutch is of a circular flat plate. Okay, clutch jo hai wo circular flat plate hota hai. Okay, cone clutch mein jo clutch hota hai wo conical hota hai. In cone clutch, the clutch is conical. So what is the difference between plate clutch and cone clutch? It is the shape, my friend. Okay, here it is a flat plate, circular plate, and here it is a conical plate. Centrifugal clutch is completely different. Centrifugal clutch is completely different. Its working, its principle, everything is completely different. Plate clutch and cone clutch, they are almost similar. The difference is here the clutch is circular plate and here the clutch is conical. Okay, that is the difference between plate clutch and cone clutch. Centrifugal clutch is a completely different clutch. Okay, so one by one we will get into the details. Okay. Now, my friend, plate clutch are also of two types: single plate, multi plate. Single plate means there are only one pair of plates. Okay, one pair of plate, one plate here, one plate here. Multi plate means multiple plates. Okay, so single plate means one pair of plate, Multiplate means multiple pairs of plate, my friend. Okay, where they are used, single plate clutches are used practically in cars, buses, trucks. Okay, so in large size automobile, because single plate sizes is big. Okay, we have single plate ka size jo hota hai, wo bada hota hai. So that's why they are used in automobiles like cars, buses and trucks. Multiplate clutch is of small size, my friend. Multiplate clutch, here plates are multiple, so it is of small size, so it is used in motorcycles. Okay, why we cannot use single plate clutch in motorcycles? Because the size of single plate clutch is bigger than multiplate clutch. So that's why it is used in cars, buses and trucks. Okay, in some cars multiplate clutch is also used. That we will discuss further, my friend. Okay, here I am just giving an example where which clutch is used. We will see them in detail, my friend. Okay, now cone clutch is used in racing cars. Okay, Formula One racing car, rally car, dirt cars. So these cars use cone clutch. Why? Because in case of cone clutch, there is sudden engagement and disengagement. आपने प्लेन क्लच यूज किया होगा, प्लेट क्लच यू माइट हैव यूज्ड इन योर कार्स, राइट? सो व्हेनेवर वी नीड टू प्रेस द क्लच, वी हैव टू प्रेस दिस कंप्लीटली, माय फ्रेंड. सो इट टेक्स टाइम टू डिसएंगेज द क्लच. इन केस ऑफ प्लेट क्लच वी नीड सम टाइम टू डिसएंगेज द क्लच. बट कोन क्लच, माय फ्रेंड, इन केस ऑफ कोन क्लच देयर इज रैपिड डिसएंगेजमेंट, इट इज रैपिडली डिसएंगेज. So in case of racing cars, we don't have that much time. We have to rapidly disengage. So that's why we use cone clutch. Okay, ek-ek karke detail mein dekhenge. Right now, I'm just giving an overview. And centrifugal clutch, where centrifugal clutches are used, mopeds. Mopeds means Scooty, Activa. These are known as mopeds, right? Lightweight vehicles, right? So these vehicles use centrifugal clutch. Golf carts, okay, the vehicle which is used in golf, when they play golf, and when they hit the ball from one point to another point in order to go, they use golf cart, right? So in golf cart, in lawn mowers, mopeds, all these machineries use centrifugal clutch. Okay, so one by one we have to design the friction clutches, plate clutch, cone clutch and centrifugal clutch. One by one we will see the design process of every clutch, my friend. Okay, so we are going to see first plate clutch. Okay, first we will see plate clutch, and in plate clutch also the first clutch that we are going to see is single plate clutch. Okay, so sabse pehle plate clutch padhenge, aur plate clutch mein bhi kya padhenge? Single plate clutch. Okay, there are four types of clutches we have to design: single plate clutch, multi plate clutch, cone clutch, centrifugal clutch. So one by one we will see each clutch. So let's start with the single plate clutch. So this is a schematic, this is a diagram of a single plate clutch. Understand this, my friend, understand this. This part is your input part, my friend. This is known as flywheel, my friend. This blue color part is the flywheel, which is the input part. Okay, this is the input part. This is the driving shaft. So this plate, let's say, is connected to the driving shaft. This blue part is continuously running. Okay, this blue part, this flywheel is continuously running. Okay, and this is the clutch plate. This is the clutch plate, my friend. This clutch plate will transfer the power, my friend. And this is the pressure plate. Okay, what is pressure plate? It is used to apply the pressure on the clutch plate, so that the clutch plate will be engaged with the flywheel. Okay, flywheel is continuously running. So let's say this is your input, this blue part is your input, and this part, clutch plate, is your output. Okay, so if you want to engage them, then what you will do, you will apply pressure on the pressure plate, so it will be engaged. And if you want to disengage them, then you will apply a negative pressure, you will apply a negative force in this direction, and it will disengage. Okay, now my friend, by default it is in engaged position. By default jo clutch plate hoti hai wo engage hoti hai. By default jo hai, it is engaged. Whenever you want to disengage, you will apply a load on this paddle, and this paddle will apply a force on this pressure plate, which will disengage the clutch plate. Okay, right now the pressure plate is engaged. See this spring, right now the pressure plate is engaged. Right now the pressure plate is pressing the clutch plate. Right now, by default, pressure plate is pressing the clutch plate. When you will apply a load on the pedal, then it will apply a load here, and this pressure plate will release the pressure. Okay, the pressure plate will move back. The pressure plate will move back and it will release the pressure. So clutch plate will stop rotating. Flywheel is continuously rotating, but clutch plate will stop rotating. In real life, they look like this. In real life, they look like this, my friend. Okay, so what is this, my friend? What is this? This is, my friend, is the flywheel. Okay, look at this. This is the flywheel part. This is the blue part. Okay, this is the blue part, which is continuously running. Okay, this, my friend, is the clutch plate. Okay, this, my friend, is the clutch plate. So this is the output part. My friend. Okay, look at this. There is friction material on the surface. This black part, it is friction material. Okay, so this is the clutch plate, my friend. And what is this? This is your pressure plate, my friend. So do you understand? The three major parts of clutch. Do you understand? And I am showing you the real life image, my friend, so that you will be able to understand it better, so that you will be able to connect them with real life. Okay, so this is just a diagram and this is the real life picture, my friend. These are the real images. So this is the flywheel, this is the clutch plate, and this is the pressure plate. Okay, now my friend, let's understand the working using animation. I told you, lots of animation, full of animation. Machine design is going to be full of animation, my friend. Okay, all right, so let's understand the working using the animation, my friend. Okay, so let's understand how the single plate works, single plate clutch works. Okay, so this is the animation, my friend. This is the construction. So look at this. First, there is flywheel. This green part is the flywheel, my friend. Okay, then this is the friction lining, my friend. Okay, this is the friction lining clutch plate. You can say it is a clutch plate. And then there is bearing and the shaft. This is the shaft which is connected to the output, my friend. Flywheel is the input and the shaft is the output, my friend, which is connected to the clutch plate. Okay, so look at this. Clutch plate has friction surface on both sides. Okay, now my friend there will be pressure plate. Connected on the clutch plate. See, flywheel, clutch plate, pressure plate. Flywheel, clutch plate, pressure plate. And my friend, there is diaphragm spring. This is known as diaphragm. This part, my friend, is known as diaphragm. Okay, this part is known as diaphragm. It is flexible so that it can apply pressure, and if it moves back, the pressure will release. Okay, now my friend, look at the working. This is the construction. Again, we will see the construction. Flywheel, then friction lining means this part. This is the friction lining. Okay, this is the friction lining. Why? Because friction must be more. Coefficient of friction should be high. So we are using some special material which is known as friction lining. Do you understand this? The friction between the contacting surfaces should be as high as possible. Then only you will be able to transfer a high torque. Agar aapko bahut zyada torque transfer karna hai, तो फ्रिक्शन बहुत ज्यादा होना चाहिए, जिसके लिए हम कुछ स्पेशल मटेरियल यूज करते हैं, विच इज नोन एज फ्रिक्शन लाइनिंग. डू यू अंडरस्टैंड दिस पार्ट, माय फ्रेंड? ओके, सो दिस इज फ्रिक्शन लाइनिंग. ओके, देन कम्स क्लच प्लेट. ओके, फ्रिक्शन लाइनिंग इज अटैच्ड ऑन द क्लच प्लेट. ओके, देन कम्स प्रेशर प्लेट. फ्लाईव्हील, क्लच प्लेट, प्रेशर प्लेट. ओके, नाउ अंडरस्टैंड द वर्किंग, माय फ्रेंड. Understand the working. Right now, my friend, this flywheel is rotating continuously. Flywheel, this green part is always rotating. But this part, my friend, clutch plate, this output part will only rotate when it will be connected. Okay, so by default, it is connected. Like this. By default, it is connected. When you will press the pedal, it will be disconnected. Did you see? When you will press the pedal, by default it is connected. See, everything is rotating. But when you will press the pedal, it will be disconnected. See, this pressure plate will move back and it will release the pressure. Right now it is pressing. See, right now it is pressing the clutch plate. This pressure plate is pressing the clutch plate. When you will apply load on the paddle, then the pressure will release and it will be disconnected. See, right now it is connected. When you will press the pedal, it is disconnected. Only flywheel is rotating, other things are stopped. Only flywheel is rotating, other things are stopped. When you will release the pressure, it will automatically be connected. When you will release the pressure from the pedal, it will automatically be connected. So by default it is connected, but when you will press the pedal, it will release the pressure from the pressure plate and it will be disconnected like this. Okay, do you understand this process, my friend? Do you understand the working? Do you understand the working, my friend? Do you understand the working? See, flywheel, clutch plate, pressure plate, three major parts. Okay, right now it is connected by default. When you will press the paddle, when you will press the paddle, it will disconnect. When you will press the paddle, it will disconnect. See, when you will press the paddle, disconnected. Only flywheel is running, this part is stopped. Now it is again connected, everything is running. Now it is connected, everything is running. Again stop. So do you understand the process, my friend? Do you understand? This is the flywheel, this is the clutch plate, and this is the pressure plate. Okay, flywheel, clutch plate, pressure plate. Okay, on clutch plate there is friction lining. This part is friction lining. Okay, this part is friction lining. Why? Because coefficient of friction should be high. My friend, this is the clutch plate. This is the clutch plate. See, this part is known as friction lining, which is the most important part for us. Okay, if you want to design the clutch, then this part is most important. Why? Because, my friend, in order to transfer torque, you need friction. And which surface is generating friction? Which surface is in contact? Which surface is generating friction? See, which surface is in contact? This surface is in contact, right? This surface will be in contact with the flywheel. Okay, this surface will be in contact with the flywheel. See, this surface, it will be in contact with the flywheel. So that's why we have to design this part, friction lining. Do you understand this, my friend? It is very important to understand what we are going to do in design. What we are going to design? So we are going to design the friction lining, my friend. Okay, this is the clutch plate. Do you see these springs? Do you notice these springs? These springs are there to dampen the vibration. Okay, springs ka kaam kya hai? Vibration ko damped karna. Okay, to spring jo hai wo torque transfer karne ke liye koi contribution nahi de raha hai. Springs are only there to dampen the vibration. Okay, this is the major part of the clutch plate, which is known as the friction lining. Do you understand this much, my friend? You have to relate it with the practical life, my friend. Okay, you have to understand what part we are going to design. So we are going to design the friction lining of the clutch plate. This friction lining, it is made of high friction material. Okay, friction lining is made of high friction material. I told you, in case of brakes also, we need high friction, coefficient of friction. In order to transfer more torque, we need high coefficient of friction. So we use special material which has high coefficient of friction. Examples are carbon fiber. Nowadays carbon fiber is used, asbestos, or you can use metal coating. Okay, you can use metal coating also. Some metals also have high coefficient of friction, like cast iron. Okay, so this is made of special material which can transfer more amount of torque because coefficient of friction is high. Do you understand this much? So let's get into the design part. Okay, we have seen the working, we have seen the real life image, we have seen the working principle. Let's get into the design part. Okay, so design part pe aate hain. So this is the friction lining. Okay, isse relate karke dekho, relate it with the real life image. This is the friction lining. Okay, we need to design this friction lining. Okay, we need to design this friction lining means we need to find what will be the appropriate dimension. Okay, so let's say, my friend, let's say the inner radius of this friction lining, let's say the inner radius of friction lining is R1. Okay, let's say the inner radius of friction lining is R1. Let's say the outer radius of friction lining is R2. Okay, let's say the outer radius is R2. The outer radius of friction lining is R2. Okay, so these two are the dimensions which you need to find. Okay, let's say these two are the dimensions which you need to find. Okay, and my friend, we have to derive two equations in case of clutch. Understand what are these two equations. Okay, we have to derive two equations in case of clutch. In case of clutch, the first equation that we will derive is the axial load, my friend. Is the axial load. What is the axial load, my friend? What is the axial load? See, when the clutch is engaged, the pressure plate is applying some load on the clutch plate, right? The pressure plate is applying load on the clutch plate in order to engage it. Then only the clutch plate will be engaged with the flywheel, right? आपको क्लच प्लेट और फ्लाईव्हील को कनेक्ट करके रखना है. यू हैव टू कनेक्ट द क्लच प्लेट एंड फ्लाईव्हील. सो यू हैव टू अप्लाई सम लोड. दिस लोड इज द एक्सियल लोड माय फ्रेंड. इट इज इन एक्सियल डायरेक्शन, राइट? दिस इज द शाफ्ट. दिस इज द शाफ्ट. दिस इज द एक्सियल डायरेक्शन. दिस इज द एक्सियल डायरेक्शन. सो दिस लोड इज द एक्सियल लोड माय फ्रेंड. सो दिस फर्स्ट डेरिवेशन विल बी फॉर द एक्सियल लोड. वी विल फाइंड सम रिलेशन बिटवीन डब्ल्यू एंड आर वन आर टू. ओके, अंडरस्टैंड द प्रोसेस. आपको प्रोसेस पहले समझना है, उसके बाद प्रोसेस स्टार्ट करेंगे. ओके, अंडरस्टैंड द प्रोसेस फर्स्ट. ओके, देन वी विल स्टार्ट द डेरिवेशन. सो फर्स्ट इक्वेशन दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिराइव इज बिटवीन डब्ल्यू एंड आर वन आर टू. डब्ल्यू एंड आर वन आर टू. दिस इज द फर्स्ट मेजर थिंग. ओके, द सेकेंड थिंग इज टॉर्क ट्रांसफर. हाउ मच टॉर्क कैन यू ट्रांसफर फ्रॉम दिस क्लच? दैट इज द सेकेंड डेरिवेशन. ओके, सो देर विल बी सम रिलेशन बिटवीन टॉर्क एंड आर वन आर टू. So we need to find two basic equations. Okay, there are two unknowns, R1, R2. Let's say you want to find the values of R1, R2. So you need two equations. What will be the first equation? Equation of W. So there will be some relation between W and R1, R2. Second equation will be equation of torque. So there will be some relation between torque and R1, R2. Okay, so let's write it down. Let's write it down, my friend. So R1 is what? R1 is inner radius of friction lining. R1 is inner radius of friction lining. Okay, what is R2, my friend? R2 is outer radius of friction lining. Okay, so these are the dimensions of the friction lining. Okay, these are the dimensions of the friction lining. Why we are only interested in friction lining? I told you, because this surface will be in contact with the flywheel. So this surface is going to transfer the torque. Whatever torque is transferred, it is by means of this surface. Okay, coefficient of friction will be on this surface. Friction force will be on this surface. So that's why we need to design this surface. Okay, so R1, R2 are the dimensions of this friction lining. What is the W, my friend? W is the axial load. W is the axial load of engagement. Means if this much load is applied, then only it will be engaged. And how this load is applied, my friend? Through the pressure plate. Okay, through the pressure plate. Pressure plate is pressing against the clutch plate. So axial load of engagement, and it is the axial load of disengagement also. Because if you want to disengage, you have to apply this much load in opposite direction. Okay, right now pressure plate is applying W load. So if you want to disengage, what you will do? You will apply a load W in opposite direction. So when we press the pedal, that W load is applied in opposite direction, which disengages the clutch. Okay, so it is the load for engagement as well as disengagement. Okay, and T is maximum torque transfer. Okay, what is T? It is the maximum torque transfer, or you can say torque transfer capacity. It is the torque transfer capacity. Okay, we need to know how much torque it can transfer, right? So there must be some relation between T and R1, R2. If R1 and R2 are this much, then this much torque you will get. If R1 and R2 are this much torque you will get. Okay, so there will be some relation between T and R1, R2. So do you understand this one? This thing? We need to find two relation between W and R1, R2 and T and R1, R2. Okay, mu is the coefficient of friction. Mu is coefficient of friction. Okay, and my friend, when this clutch plate presses the flywheel, when the clutch plate is in contact with the flywheel, there will be some pressure acting on the surface of this clutch plate, right? There will be some pressure on this friction lining. The maximum value of pressure is, let's say, P. So what is P, my friend? It is the maximum pressure. It is the maximum pressure on friction lining. This is also an important factor. This is also an important factor. Why, my friend? Because your friction lining should sustain this much pressure, okay? Whatever pressure is applied on this plate, it should sustain that much pressure. Otherwise, what will happen? The pressure plate, this plate will break. Okay, so whenever you are designing the friction plate, then mu is also important. It should have high coefficient of friction, and P is also important. Pressure, how much pressure it can sustain. If you are using a material, which has high coefficient of friction, but it cannot sustain pressure, what will happen? When you will engage the clutch, it will break. If it cannot sustain that much pressure, it will break. So these two are important properties for friction lining, okay? Mu should also be high and pressure should also be high. Pressure between the friction lining and flywheel is usually 0 to 2 megapascal, okay? Usually this pressure is between 0 to 2 megapascal. Whatever material we use, usually maximum pressure varies between 0 to 2 megapascal, 0.5 megapascal, 1 megapascal, 1.5 megapascal, okay? So for different material, maximum value of pressure will be different. Maximum pressure means how much pressure it can sustain, okay? So how much pressure it can sustain, it is important. Why? Otherwise it will break. If you don't know how much pressure you can put on that, if you are applying more pressure, it can sustain, let's say it can only sustain 1 megapascal, and you are applying too much load and the pressure is 2 megapascal, what will happen to the plate? The plate will simply break. So these two things are very important for the clutch plate, mu and P. It should have high coefficient of friction and it should be able to sustain that much pressure, okay? So we need to find these two equations, my friend. Equation of W, equation of T, in terms of R1, in terms of R2, okay? We need to find relation of W and T with R1 and R2. Do you understand this much? Do you understand the broad process, my friend? What we are going to do? Okay, my friend. So let's start with the process, my friend, okay? So let's say W force is applied on the plate, okay? And the plate is connected with the flywheel. W force is applied on the plate and the plate is connected with the flywheel, okay? So my friend, there will be some pressure between the flywheel and the plate. जब आप लोड लगाओगे, अगर मान लो क्लच प्लेट जो है फ्लाईव्हील के साथ एंगेज्ड है, इफ द क्लच प्लेट इज एंगेज्ड विद फ्लाईव्हील, देयर विल बी सम प्रेशर एक्टिंग बिटवीन दीज टू, बिकॉज दे बोथ आर प्रेसिंग ईच अदर, ओके? दे आर प्रेसिंग ईच अदर लाइक दिस, सो देयर मस्ट बी सम प्रेशर, राइट? लेट्स से द प्रेशर इज पी. लेट्स से दिस इज द प्रेशर. सो वी आर अप्लाइंग लोड डब्ल्यू एंड दिस इज द प्रेशर, ओके? नाउ माय फ्रेंड, द फर्स्ट रिलेशन we will find is between W and R1, R2, okay? So let's find the relation between W and R1, R2, okay? So axial load W, this is the first thing that we need to find. This is the first thing that we will derive, axial load W, okay, my friend? So let's start with the derivation, okay? Simple derivation, if I explain, it will be very simple, my friend, okay? Now, my friend, understand this. We are applying a load W from this side. And the pressure is acting in opposite side. Because the flywheel is applying pressure. On clutch plate, you are applying load W from this side. And flywheel is applying pressure from this side. Okay. Now, my friend, if you apply equilibrium equation. What you will get? Summation of Fx equals to 0. Force from this side should be equals to force from this side. So W should be equal to how much? This is pressure. This is not force. So what will be force? Pressure into area. P into. What will be the area, my friend? What will be this area of friction surface? It will be pi R2 square minus R1 square, right? W will be equal to P into pi R2 square minus R1 square, right? No, my friend, it is not necessary. It is not necessary that W will be equal to P into pi R2 square minus R1 square. Why, my friend? You are forgetting one thing, my friend. P is the maximum pressure. P is the maximum pressure. But it is not necessary that the pressure is constant, my friend. It is not necessary that the pressure is constant. Let's say the pressure is varying. So in that case, you cannot find the other force by pressure into area. When can you apply this formula, pressure into area? This W is the load from this side. It will be equal to load from this side. Okay, load from this side. So load from this side will be equal to pressure into area when the pressure will be uniformly distributed. Okay, there are two types of distribution. This is uniform distribution and this is parabolic distribution. See, this is uniform distribution, parabolic distribution. See, so in this case, you cannot use pressure into area. But in this case, you cannot use pressure into area. Do you understand my point? Here what I did, my friend. I applied equilibrium equation. Okay. Load from this side. W will be equal to load from this side. Pressure into area. But this formula is only applicable when pressure is constant, my friend. So right now, I cannot use this. Right now, I cannot use this. Okay, forget about this. Right now, we cannot use this. Why? Because right now, we don't know what is the distribution of pressure. We only know that maximum pressure is P. But we don't know whether it is constant or it is changing. Okay, so that we will consider later. Okay, so we can't calculate the load directly by pressure into area. So what we will do, my friend? Very simple. We will consider a very thin strip, my friend. Look at this yellow part. This yellow part, my friend, is a very thin strip. Okay. Why I am considering this? Because first, my friend, I will find what is the force on this yellow part. I cannot find the force on the complete friction lining. Why? Because I don't know whether the pressure is constant or different. Okay. So I cannot consider the entire friction lining. So what I am going to do, I am going to consider only this yellow part. I will find the load on this and then I will integrate it. Do you understand the process? Right now, what is the problem? The problem is we don't know whether this pressure is constant or it is changing. So we cannot find the force by pressure into area. But we can find the load on this yellow part. Very small part. This is a very small strip. And if you find the load on this very small strip, what you have to do? You have to integrate that equation. Okay. So let's say this small strip is at R distance from center. Okay. This is the center. So it is at R distance from center. And the thickness of this small strip is, let's say, dr. Okay. The thickness of this very small strip is, let's say, dr, my friend. Okay. dr. Thickness of this small strip is dr. Now, my friend, If this strip is very small, can I assume that the pressure on this very small strip is almost constant? The pressure on this entire surface is not constant right now. But if you consider only this much thickness, can you assume the pressure is almost constant? Russ, you can do that. Yeah, right. Why I am assuming a very small element? Because I can assume that pressure is almost constant on this yellow surface. And if it is almost constant, then you can find the force by pressure into area. Pressure into area karke load kab nikal sakte hain? When you can calculate load by pressure into area? When the pressure is constant. On this black surface, pressure right now is not constant. So we cannot calculate the load on black surface. But on yellow surface, it is a very small surface. So pressure can almost be constant on this yellow surface, right? I can assume that pressure is almost constant. So on yellow surface, I can find the force by pressure into area. Do you understand this much? So let's first find the force on yellow part. Okay, so what will be the area of the element, my friend? What will be the area of element? Element means yellow part. Area of element. Element means yellow part. I am writing it yellow part so that you will be able to relate. Otherwise you will get confused. What element? So yellow part is element. Okay, very small element. So area of the element, let's say area is dA. What will be the area? It is at r distance and thickness is dr. The radius of this element is r and thickness is dr. So what will be the area, my friend? 2 pi r dr, right? Circumference into thickness. When you have a very small thickness of a hollow circle, then the area is 2 pi r dr. But this thickness is large, so the area of this black surface will not be 2 pi r into thickness. It will be pi r2 square minus r1 square. Okay, so this thickness is very small, so that's why area will be 2 pi r into thickness. Okay, so what will be the force on axial load? What will be the axial load on element? What will be the axial load on element, my friend? I told you, I can assume that pressure on this yellow part is almost constant. Okay, so what will be the load on yellow part? dW. This is the load on yellow part. Okay, total load is W, but load on yellow part is dW. So dW will be equal to pressure into area, P into dA, right? P is pressure, dA is area. So P into 2 pi r dr. So this is the axial load only on the element, my friend. Okay, on this yellow part, the load is pressure into area. Now, my friend, if this is the axial load on element, what will be the axial load on complete friction lining? What will be the total load on the complete friction lining? W will be equal to integration of dW. Very simple, my friend. I first found the equation of dW for this yellow part, and now I will integrate it simply. So what will be the limit of integration, my friend? What will be the limit of integration? R will vary from R1 to R2, right? R will vary from R1 to R2. So the limit will be R1 to R2, my friend. So what will be the equation of W? What will be the equation of W, my friend? W will be equal to integration R1 to R2 P into 2 pi r dr. This will be the equation of W, my friend. This will be the equation of W. Do you understand this, my friend? What we did? We first found the equation of W on the element and then we integrated. But my friend, the problem is right now we cannot integrate this equation. Why? Because right now we don't know whether the pressure is constant or whether it is changing. If you want to integrate pressure, then you must know whether it is constant or changing. If it is constant, it will not be integrated. It will come out of the integration. And if it is changing, then you must know what is the equation of pressure in terms of R. Here, integration is in terms of R. Integration is with respect to R. So if P is changing with respect to R, if pressure is changing with respect to R, you must know the equation of pressure. So right now we don't know whether pressure is constant or changing. So that's why right now we cannot integrate it. We will integrate it later. Okay. Now, my friend. We have to find the equation of T also. We have found equation of W. We have to find the equation of torque also. Okay. So maximum torque capacity that we have to find. How much torque it can transfer, that also we need to find. Okay, we need to find relation of torque also. So how will we find it, my friend? First of all, axial force is acting perpendicular to this surface. Okay, this is the side view, cross section. Axial force is acting like this, perpendicular to the surface. So if axial force is W, what will be the friction force, my friend? What will be the friction force? See, friction force will be acting like this. Friction force will be acting like this. At this point, friction force will be acting like this. At this point, friction force will be acting like this. At this point, it will be acting like this. At this point, it will be acting like this. At this point, it will be acting like this. At this point, it will be acting like this. This is what? Friction force. This is what? Friction force. Okay? So this friction force will rotate the friction lining. Okay? It will apply torque which will rotate the friction lining. Do you understand this, my friend? Do you understand this? Let's say it is rotating. Clockwise. So how it is rotating, my friend? How it is rotating, my friend? It is rotating due to friction force. The friction force is applying the torque, my friend. Do you understand this? Axial force is acting like this, normal. Axial force is acting normal to the surface. If this is the surface, axial force is acting like this, normal. And friction force is acting like this, parallel. Axial force is acting normal. Friction force is acting parallel, my friend. So this is what? Friction force. Let's say friction force on the surface, on yellow surface, my friend. First, we will derive the equation on yellow surface. So friction force on yellow surface is, let's say, df. Friction force on yellow surface is, let's say, df. Okay. So let's say friction force is df. Okay. What will be the value of friction force? Friction force on yellow surface, not on complete surface. Friction force on element, yellow surface, df, will be equal to how much? What is friction force, my friend? Mu into normal force, right? Friction force means mu into normal force. And what is your normal force? Axial force, right? Axial force is the normal force on the surface. Friction force is parallel, axial force is normal. So friction force will be mu into normal force, which is dw. Okay, what is the normal force on yellow surface? dw. So friction force will be mu times dw. And what is dw? P into 2 pi r dr. So this is the friction force. And this friction force is acting at what distance, my friend? What is the distance? This friction force is acting at what distance? This friction force is acting at a distance r. This distance is how much, my friend? This distance is r. So what will be the torque applied by the friction force? Torque applied by friction force. What will be the torque, my friend? Force into distance. So torque dt will be equal to df multiplied by r. Df multiplied by r. So how much will this be, my friend? It will become mu into p into 2 pi r square dr. Okay, multiply r in this equation. Are you getting, my friend? Are you getting the derivation? We need to find the torque. Okay, so how much will be the torque? Friction force into distance. This friction force is applying torque. Then only it is rotating. Okay, which will rotate the friction surface? This friction force will rotate the friction surface. Okay, so friction force into distance is the torque. Now, my friend, this is the torque by the yellow surface. What will be the torque transferred by complete surface? T will be equal to integration dt. T will be equal to integration dt from R1 to R2, my friend. So what will be the equation of T? T will be equal to integration R1 to R2 mu into P into 2 pi R square dr. Do you understand this much, my friend? So we have derived the equation of torque also. But here also we are facing the same problem. We don't know whether the pressure is constant or whether it is changing. So right now we cannot integrate this equation. We have found the equation of W and the equation of torque, but we cannot integrate this equation. Why we cannot integrate? Because we don't know what is the relation between pressure and radius. We don't know whether the pressure is constant or if it is changing. If it is changing, how it is changing? Linearly, parabolically, what is the relation between pressure and radius? That we don't know. So do you understand this much, my friend? Very good, my friend. Now, my friend, in order to find relation between pressure and radius, in order to find relation, we need to find a relation between pressure and radius, then only we will be able to integrate these two equations, this equation and this equation, okay, this equation and this equation. So in order to find the relation between pressure and radius, we have two theories, my friend, uniform pressure theory and uniform wear theory. Do you understand this much? Why we need these theories? Because we need to know what is the relation between pressure and radius. Without that relation, we cannot derive the equation of W and equation of torque. Right now they are in integration form. If you want to integrate this, you need relation between pressure and radius. And in order to find that relation, what we are going to use? We are going to use two theories, uniform pressure theory and uniform wear theory. So let's first use uniform pressure theory. So according to this theory, we assume that pressure is constant. Okay, according to this theory, we assume that pressure is constant. And when we can assume this, when we can assume that the pressure is constant, if the clutch is new, my friend, if clutch is new, we can assume pressure is constant. If the clutch is new, then we can assume pressure is constant. Do you understand my point, my friend? If the clutch is new, there is no wear on the surface. So we can assume that the pressure is almost constant. So this theory is used for a new clutch. Do you understand this much, my friend? This theory is used for a new clutch, because if there is new clutch, then there will be no wear on the surface. We can assume that the pressure is constant, my friend. So if we put pressure constant, if we put pressure equals to constant, then what will happen, my friend? If pressure is constant, then the pressure will come out of the integration, right? So we have the equation of W and torque. So W is integration R1 to R2 P into 2 pi R dr, right? So let's integrate this equation now. So it will become W equals to integration R1 to R2 P into 2 pi R dr. Now pressure is constant, so it will come out of the integration, right? Pressure is constant, so it will come out of the integration. So it will become P into 2 pi is also constant. It will become integration R dr from R1 to R2. And if you integrate this, what you will get, my friend? If you integrate R, you will get R square by 2. 2 and 2 will be cancelled. What you will get? P into pi R2 square minus R1 square. This is the equation of axial load, my friend, according to uniform pressure theory. According to uniform pressure theory, this is the equation of the axial load W. Okay. Now we also need to find equation of torque. So what will be the equation of torque, my friend? Equation of torque will be T equals to. What was the equation of torque? Integration R1 to R2 mu into P into 2 pi R square dr. So it will be integration R1 to R2 mu into P into 2 pi R square dr. Now my friend, mu, P and 2 pi, these things are constant. So it will be integration R1 to R2 R square dr. And if you integrate it, what you will get, my friend? What you will get if you integrate it? You will get mu into P into 2 pi आर टू क्यूब माइनस आर वन क्यूब डिवाइडेड बाय थ्री. सो दिस इज द इक्वेशन ऑफ टॉर्क अकॉर्डिंग टू यूनिफॉर्म प्रेशर थ्योरी, माई फ्रेंड. सो इफ द प्रेशर इज कॉन्स्टेंट, विच वी कैन अज्यूम इन केस ऑफ न्यू क्लच, इफ द प्रेशर इज कॉन्स्टेंट देन W will be P into pi R2 square minus R1 square and torque will be mu into P into 2 by 3 pi R2 cube minus R1 cube. You have to remember these equations, my friend. You have to memorize these equations because there will be numericals based on these equations. You have to solve those numericals by putting the values in these equations. So remember this formula, okay? Remember, you have to remember this formula. W equals to P into pi R2 square minus R1 square. And torque is mu into P into 2 by 3 pi R2 cube minus R1 cube. But these equations are according to uniform pressure theory, my friend. Okay. Now, my friend, if I write the equation of torque in terms of W, then what I will get, my friend? If I write the equation of torque in terms of W, see, here W is P into pi R2 square minus R1 square, right? So what will be the value of P in terms of W? What will be the value of P in terms of W, my friend? It will be W upon pi R2 square minus R1 square, right? From here, you can put W equals P equals to W upon pi R2 square minus R1 square divided by 2 by 3 pi R2 cube. Sorry, into 2 by 3 pi R2 cube minus R1 cube. Now, my friend, pi and pi will be cancelled. So, you will get this equation. Mu into W into 2 by 3 R2 cube minus R1 cube divided by R2 square minus R1 square. Look at this equation, my friend. If you compare this equation with this equation, my friend, T equals to mu W into R. Then what is R here, my friend? R here will be equal to 2 by 3 R2 cube minus R1 cube divided by R2 square minus R1 square. What is this, my friend? Let's understand it. This is a very important concept, my friend. You will get questions based on this concept. Okay. So let's understand this concept. My friend, if you write T equals to mu WR, what is mu W, my friend? What is this mu W here? This mu W is the friction force, right? Mu W is the friction force, right? W is the axial force. So, mu W is the friction force. So, T equals to mu W R. This means that you are assuming that the entire friction force, mu W, is acting at this distance. Actually, the friction force is acting at different distance. Okay, at every point of the friction surface, the friction force is acting. So actually, it is acting at every point like this. Actually, it is acting like here. There is a friction force here. Sorry. Actually, the friction forces are acting at different points. Okay, so there is a friction force here. This is a friction force here. This is a friction force at different points. But if we assume that the friction force is concentrated at one point, then that distance where the friction force is acting is known as mean radius of friction, my friend. Okay. So what is R, my friend? What is this R? Sorry for this. Let me get back to this. Okay. So what is this equation, my friend? What is this mu W R? Here we are assuming that entire friction force is acting at some distance R. So this R is known as mean radius of friction, my friend. It is an important term. What is mean radius of friction, my friend? What is mean radius of friction? Let's say you have entire friction force acting at one point. Okay, let's say you have entire friction force acting at one distance. Then that distance where the entire friction force can be assumed to be acting. Right now, actually, friction force is not acting at one distance. It is acting at different points. At every point, friction force is distributed. But if we assume that friction force is acting at one distance, then that distance is known as mean radius of friction. You have to memorize this formula also. Very easy, my friend. Very easy. If you remember this equation and this equation, then you can easily derive this. What you have to do? Just put the value of P in terms of W here. Okay? And write it in this term. Mu W into distance. So this distance is known as mean radius of friction, my friend. So this is mean radius of friction according to uniform pressure theory, which is used for the new clutch. Why? Because in case of new clutch, the surface is not worn. Okay? There is no wear on the surface. But as the surface starts to wear, if you use the clutch, there will be wear on the surface because it is friction, my friend. And friction will cause wear on the surface. Then, my friend, your pressure will not be distributed uniformly, my friend. So in that case, for old clutch, we use uniform wear theory. So uniform wear theory is used for which clutch? Old clutch, my friend. Okay, so in case of old clutch, for old clutches, we cannot assume pressure is constant. So what we assume rate of wear is constant or uniform. Rate of wear is uniform. Okay, rate of wear means the rate at which wear is taking place, it is constant, my friend. Okay, now my friend, rate of wear depends upon two things, my friend. Rate of wear is proportional to the product of P into R. Okay, rate of wear means the rate at which wear is taking place. So rate of wear is proportional to P into R. So if you assume rate of wear is constant, so P into R will be constant, right? P into R will be constant. Let's say C is a constant value. Okay, let's say C is a constant value, and I am assuming P into R is equal to C. Okay, P into R is what? It is proportional to rate of wear. So if rate of wear is constant, means P into R is constant. So let's say P into R is some constant value C. So from here, my friend, I can write P equals to C by R. Now, my friend, put the value of P in these equations. Put the value of P in this equation and in this equation. Again, we will integrate it and we will find W and torque. Okay? According to uniform wear theory. Okay? According to uniform wear theory. So, what was the equation of W, my friend? Integration R1 to R2 P into 2 pi R dr. Right? So, what we will do? We will put the value of P in terms of C. P equals to C by R, right? Where C is what? It is some constant, my friend. So this R and R will be cancelled, right? R and R will be cancelled. And C is a constant. So it will come out of the integration. So what you will get? C into 2 pi integration R1 to R2 dr. So if you integrate it, what you will get? W equals to C into 2 pi R2 minus R1, my friend, right? Where C is what? C is a constant. It is a product of P and R. P into R. C is P into R. So do you understand, my friend? Do you understand? This is the equation of W according to uniform wear theory, my friend. According to uniform wear theory. We have derived the equation according to pressure theory also. Okay, now we will derive the equation of torque. we will derive the equation of torque. Okay, we will derive the equation of torque also. So let's derive the equation of torque. So what was the equation of torque? What was the equation of torque? T equals to integration R1 to R2 mu into P into 2 pi R square dr, right? So put the value of P C by R in terms of C. So it will become mu into C by R 2 pi R square dr. R and 1 R will be cancelled. What you will get, my friend? Whatever is constant, it will come out. So mu will come out, C will come out, 2 pi will come out. And you will get integration R1 to R2 R dr. Okay, R dr. 1 R is cancelled. Okay. Now, my friend, if you integrate it, what you will get? If you integrate it, you will get this mu into C into pi R2 square minus R1 square. This is the equation of torque. So we have, my friend, two equations according to uniform pressure theory and two equations according to uniform wear theory. You have to memorize these four equations. This equation is according to pressure theory. This equation is according to pressure theory. Equation of W, equation of torque. And these equations are according to wear theory. Equation of W, equation of torque. So you have to memorize these four equations. And here also, we will find the radius of friction. Okay, so let's find the radius of friction. So here, my friend, if you put the value of C in terms of W, what you will get? W upon 2 pi R2 minus R1 multiplied by pi R2 square minus R1 square. Pi and pi will be cancelled. R2 minus R1, and this can be written as R2 minus R1 into R2 plus R1. A square minus B square, I can write it as A plus B, A minus B. So A minus B will be cancelled. And what you will get, my friend? T equals to, you will get this, mu into W into mu into W, pi and pi is cancelled, into R2 plus R1 divided by 2. So here, what is mean radius of friction, my friend? Here the mean radius of friction is R1 plus R2 by 2. This is the equation of mean radius of friction according to uniform wear theory. Okay, so we have mean radius of friction according to pressure theory, and we have mean radius of friction according to wear theory, my friend. Okay, so my friend, you need to remember these equations according to pressure theory, equation of W and T, and according to wear theory, equation of W and T. Your questions, numericals will be solved directly using this formula, my friend. Okay, so we have derived two equations today according to uniform pressure theory and two equations according to uniform wear theory, equation of W and equation of T. What type of questions will you get, my friend? In numericals, they will give you all these value R1, R2, they will give you R1, they will give you R2, they will give you mu, and they will give you P, and they will ask you what is W and what is T. Okay, so these are the parameters R1, R2, W, T, mu, P. So out of these, they will give you R1, R2, mu and P, and they will ask you to find the value of W and the value of T. In most of the problem, they ask the value of torque. Okay, in most of the problem, they ask the value of torque. Okay, now my friend, in uniform wear theory question, in order to use this formula, you have to calculate C. So how will we calculate C, my friend? In order to calculate C, they always give maximum pressure. Okay, so what is C, my friend? What is C? C is P into R. P into R is equal to C. Okay, so it means that at minimum radius, pressure is maximum, like this. At minimum radius, pressure is maximum, and at maximum radius, pressure is minimum. Okay, at minimum radius, this is the minimum radius R1, pressure is maximum, and at maximum radius, pressure is minimum. So if they give you P maximum, then this R will be what? R1 or R2. If they give you P maximum, then this R will be R1 or R2, my friend. This R will be R1 or R2. It will be R1, my friend, because maximum pressure will act at R1, my friend. Okay, maximum pressure will act at this minimum radius. So it will be R1. So in order to calculate C, you will use this equation. In order to calculate C, you will use this equation P max into R1, my friend. Okay, so you can use this to calculate the value of C. And once you get the value of C, then you can put the value of C in this equation, and you can find W, you can find torque. Do you understand this much, my friend? Do you understand this much? Very good if you have understood this much, my friend. So today we have seen what is the equation of W and T according to pressure theory and wear theory. In tomorrow's lecture, I will explain you when to use pressure theory and when to use wear theory, my friend. Okay, for designing purpose, if you want to design a clutch, which theory you can use. And then, my friend, we will solve some numericals based on these equations. We will solve numericals from gate, directly from gate. Then you will see which type of numericals you can get. Okay, so today what we saw, today we saw what is a clutch. Okay, we saw what is a clutch, where it is used, what is the purpose of clutch. We saw different types of clutch, positive clutch and friction clutch. We saw what is positive clutch and what is friction clutch using the animation, my friend. And then we saw different types of friction clutches. What are different types of friction clutches? Plate clutch, cone clutch, centrifugal clutch. Today we saw plate clutch. Tomorrow I will explain. Tomorrow means in the next lecture. Okay, Sunday there is no lecture, my friend. Sunday is off for YouTube classes. Sunday is off. So on Monday we will discuss cone clutch and centrifugal clutch. Okay, my friend. All right, my friend. So we discussed how plate clutch works, what is the real life picture of plate clutch, what is the thing that we need to design. We design this friction lining, my friend. Okay, memorize these equations of W and T. Memorize the equations of W and T, my friend. So this was all for today's class. I hope you have enjoyed this class because of these animations. I will explain every topic of machine design using these animations so that you will have that feel. You will understand how it exactly works, my friend. Okay, Unacademy Plus, my friend. Unacademy Plus is designed especially for online learning. So you can take a subscription of Unacademy Plus, and there together we will prepare for GATE, my friend. I'm not saying that you can't prepare just by looking at these YouTube videos. You can. It will be like a self-study. You have to put a lot of hard work. You have to find all the topics, and whatever topics we are not able to cover here, you have to study that from textbooks. So you can prepare using YouTube videos also. But if you want to prepare in detail, in a structured manner, one by one, you want to complete all the subjects, then come on Unacademy Plus, because this online platform is especially designed to learn, my friend, to learn. Okay, YouTube is an entertainment platform. We are using it for learning, but there are some tools which are not available here. Okay, so on Unacademy Plus, you will have daily live classes in both languages, English as well as in Hindi. There will be crash course, my friend, before every exam, GATE, engineering services, every exam, there will be crash course. There is rank improvement batch, which we are going to launch from 1st June. In this batch, my friend, we will solve a lot of quality questions, and it is going to be launched from 1st June. From 1st June, we are also launching a new batch for GATE and ESC, my friend. So take the subscription if you have still not taken the subscription, my friend. There will be doubt clearing session. Every fourth session in Unacademy Plus is dedicated to doubts. There are weekly tests also, my friend. And my friend, there are different batch courses. You can join any batch you want. Okay, multiple batches you can join. It is up to you. If you take one subscription, you can join any batch you want. You can join multiple batches. You can study use with any educator you want, my friend. It is up to you. And my friend, if you are asking why online learning, look at these diagrams, my friend. Look at these diagrams. This type of visualization is not possible in board, my friend. Okay, whiteboard, we cannot visualize these things. So these type of colorful diagrams, animations, they are only possible on online learning platform, my friend, Unacademy Plus. And my friend, a very interesting thing about Unacademy Plus, look at how the doubts are cleared. See, this is the image posted by one of the students and the teacher is explaining the solution, my friend. So you can post your numericals, you can post your doubts, you can send your doubts, and we will solve the doubts then and there, my friend. We will solve your doubt then and there. Okay, so this facility is not available on YouTube. That's why I'm telling you, this platform is specially designed for learning. And look at this leaderboard, my friend. On this leaderboard, you will see how many students got the right answer. Okay, we will poll, we will make a poll, and we will see, let's say whenever there is a problem, A, B, C, D, there are four options. Which students gave the right answer and what was the timing of every student? All this will be visible on the leaderboard so that you can compare your result with the other student. You can compete with other student. So this type of competitive environment is only possible on Unacademy Plus platform, my friend. Okay, so if you want to take the subscription, go to unacademyplus.com, pick a goal. Your goal is GATE and engineering services. And then, my friend, you have to choose the subscription. 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 24 months. 1 year and 2 year subscription are the best subscription, my friend. Why? Because per month cost is very less. And if you use this code, my friend, if you use this code, APPROVE10, if you use this code APPROVE10, then you will get 10% off. You will get 10% off. And 1 year subscription will only cost you 22,500 rupees, means around 1800 per month. Okay, and 2 year subscription will cost around 1200 per month. So can you imagine, my friend, only 1800 per month or 1200 per month you have to pay, and you can learn from the top faculties of India, my friend. And you can also take EMI, my friend, credit card EMI as well as debit card EMI. So you will only have to pay per month cost, 1800 or 1200. Okay, these are the 12 month cost. This is the EMI, my friend. See, 1875 rupees per month. You will only have to pay this much, 1875. And you can learn from the top faculties of India. You can see multiple batches. You will see multiple batches. You can join any batch you want. You can join 2-3 batches if you want, my friend. Okay, so you can prepare in a systematic manner, and all the topics will be covered, my friend. So join Unacademy Plus, because every day a lot of students are joining. A lot of students every day are joining. So don't lose in this race, my friend. Okay, every day a lot of students are joining using this code, and they have started their preparation. We are launching new batches in June, my friend. So don't forget to buy the subscription of Unacademy Plus using this code, APPROVE10, my friend. Okay, so this was all for today's lecture, my friend. I will see you in the next lecture with lots and lots of animation, lots and lots of colorful images, my friend. Till then, practice the numericals based on whatever we have covered till now, my friend. I have uploaded previous year question on Telegram channel also. So practice the question, my friend, and I will see you in the next lecture. Thank you very much for watching me.